यशोद नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोद नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जयो राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जयो राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे गोपीनाथ राधा गोपीनाथ श्री राधे जयो श्री गोपाल श्री गोपाल श्री गोपाल जयो श्री गोपाल जयो गौरनिताय 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 जयो गौरनिताय जयो जयो प्रभुपाद 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 जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर शिष्यमत अभय चरणारविंद भक्तिवेदांत गोस्वामी श्री प्रभुपाद की समवेद गौर भक्तवृंद की ग्रंथराज श्रीमद्भागवतम की निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे ऑल गुरुस असेंबल डिवोटिस ऑल गुरुस असेंबल डिवोटिस ऑल गुरुस असेंबल डिवोटिस ऑल गुरुस ऑल गुरुस ऑल गुरुस शिष्य गुरु एंड श्री गौरांग We're reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 12, Chapter 3, the Bhumi Gita, text number 48 and then 49. Vidya tapa prana nirodha maitri. Vidya tapa prana nirodha maitri. Tirtabhisheka vratadana japyai. Tirtabhisheka vratadana japyai. Natyanta shuddhim labateantaratma. Natyanta shuddhim labateantaratma. Yata hridi stite bhagavati anante. Yata hridi stite bhagavat anante. Atyanta shuddhim labhate antaratma. Saridhiste bhagavat anante. Natyanta shuddhim labhate antaratma. Yata hridi sthite bhagavat anante. Vidya tapa prana nirodha maitri. Tirta abhisheka vratadana japyai. Natyanta shuddhim labhate antaratma. Yata hridi sthite bhagavat anante. Vidya, by worship of demigods. Tapaha, austerities. Prana nirodha, exercise of breath control. Maitri, compassion. Tirtha Abhisheka, bathing in holy places. Vrata, strict vows. Dana, charity. Japyai, and chanting of various mantras. Na, not. Atyanta, complete. Shuddhim, purification. Labhate, can achieve. Antaatma, the mind. Yata, as. Hridiste, when he is present within the heart. Bhagavati, the personality of Godhead. Anante, the unlimited Lord. Translation: by one's engaging in the processes of demigod worship, austerities, breath control, compassion, bathing in holy places, strict vows, charity, and chanting of various mantras, one's mind cannot attain the same absolute purification as that achieved when the unlimited personality of Godhead appears within one's heart. There's no purport to this. We'll take the next verse, text number 49. Tasma sarvatmanarajan hridistam kuru keshavam mriyamano hi avahitas tato yashi param gatim. Tasma, therefore, sarvatmana, with all endeavor, rajan, O king, hridistam, within your heart, kuru, make, keshavam, Lord Keshava, mriyamana dying, he indeed avahita concentrated. Tataha then yasi you will go param to the supreme gatim destination. Translation and purport. Therefore, O King, endeavor with all your might to fix the Supreme Lord Keshava within your heart. Maintain this concentration upon the Lord, and at the time of death, you will certainly attain the supreme destination. Although the Supreme Lord is always in the heart of every living being, the words Hridistham Kuru Keshavam indicate that one should endeavor to realize the Lord's presence there and maintain this awareness at every moment. Parikshit Maharaj is about to give up this world and is receiving final instructions from his spiritual master, Shukadev Goswami. In the context of King's imminent departure, this verse has special significance. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadatisva Padantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yudapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhyasya Kripa Sindhu Bhyayevacha Patitanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. Just we'll read the translation, both translations again. By once engaging in the processes of demigod worship, austerities, breath control, compassion, bathing in holy places, strict vows, charity and chanting of various mantras, one's mind cannot attain the same absolute purification as that achieved when the unlimited personality of Godhead appears within one's heart. Therefore, O King, endeavor with all your might to fix the Supreme Lord Keshava within your heart. Maintain this concentration upon the Lord, and at the time of death, you will certainly attain the supreme destination. So seek blessings of all the assembled Vaishnavas that have come to hear from the Srimad Bhagavatam, and also to all the devotees that are online hearing and the Bhagavatam class every day regularly. And for the last, say, 6 months, I didn't had the austerity or the, you know, the privilege of being at this seat and speaking on the Srimad Bhagavatam. So I was considering myself very fortunate. But as soon as I had come few days back, then somewhere or other this was being mentioned, and I was fearing when will that, you know, difficulty come, and somehow it happens to be on today. And usually it is said Srimad Bhagavatam is to be received by sitting at the feet of this spiritual master, the representative of Vyasadeva, and that's what Vyasasana represents. And our only qualification to speak or be seated above the Vaishnavas is by the instruction of superiors. But of course, in the online medium, even the audience is not sitting at the feet of the speaker, but the speaker is sitting at the feet of the audience because the camera is at the top. So those Vaishnavas who are taking shelter of Bhagavatam in person, and those who I am taking shelter of by placing my feet, so seek blessings from all of them. And this particular verse is being mentioned here, that this is the final instruction of Srila Sukadeva Goswami to Maharaj Parikshit. And the final instructions always carry a lot of weightage. And we all know the story of Yamunacharya's three last wishes that he had, and which Ramanujacharya fulfilled. And because what someone speaks at the fag end of one's life, the final words are considered to be very prominent. And like at one hospital, one person was on the deathbed. And as he was on the deathbed, somebody came to see him, visit him. And as soon as this person came to see him, he started to become very restless. He started to all the parameters started to go up and down. And all the doctors, everybody came there, and they were trying to determine what exactly happened. What is it that is... all the impressions of the past, what this person did is bothering him, therefore he became very agitated, his over, all the parameters are going up and down. And finally, just before he died, somehow he took the strength to remove his mask and speak out, "You are standing on my oxygen tube," and then he died. So the visitor that came, he somehow stepped on that, you know, that line, that lifeline, and that became his deadline. So, in the movies, it's a very famous scene that somebody is shot or is about to die, is somehow or other trying to speak something very important. And, he's trying to hear, trying to make sense of it. Same way here, the final instructions of Srila Sukadeva Goswami to Maharaj Parikshit, and is very important both for Sukadeva, both for Parikshit Maharaj, and all of us who will be one day or other dying. And this was the question that Parikshit Maharaj had asked when Sukadeva Goswami arrived, that what is the duty of a person who is dying, and what is the duty of a person who during his life. And the Bhagavatam is nothing but art of living and art of dying. That how does one prepare oneself to live, and how does one live in this world. And depending on how we live, that's what determines how we live. Just like in a college, where does he land after his college is over? Very much depends on how did he live in the college. If he spent his time just wasting away, going to different restaurants, or just playing sports or different things, then that kind of life, living, will obviously he will not be able to either leave well, or if he leaves, then he won't be in a good destination. Like when I was studying at IIT Bombay, I was from 99 batch, and in our hostel register, there is all, you know, different roll numbers, and usually any college, the roll numbers are based on which year you kind of joined, and they don't change. Of course, our roll numbers in the ashram keeps changing. Sometimes it is 54, and then, you know, somebody relocates himself to another ashram, then you kind of upgrade, you become 53 or 52, or some senior may, from some other temple, he comes back, then you go down. So the roll numbers in the Brahmacharya ashram, you can't identify with one number. Even with the roll number, you can't identify. It's especially helpful when you have to put your attendance. But in colleges, it's fixed. And I still remember my roll number, 99026017. So that was my roll number, 99. 02 was my department, and 17th was where I was in the department. And in my hostel library, mess list, I saw a man whose roll number was starting with 90, not 99, but 90. And I was wondering that there is no master's degree, a PhD degree that will keep a person for 10 years. Usually 4 years, 2 years, 5 years, that's the maximum. Say, the only guess I could make is he did his BTech there, then he did his master's there, 4 plus 2, and now he is doing his PhD there, therefore he may be. So I just went and, you know, tried to find out who is this special personality who has the roll number of 90. Then he was a very happy-go-lucky guy, and he was like the Bhishma Pitama, or the guardian or the advisor giver for all who were in the hostel. And then I asked him that, how come you have this roll number? Is it a mistake, or you're doing some all degrees here? And then he said that life in a hostel and inside the campus is so peaceful, I don't even want to go out. I don't want to graduate. Because in Bombay, if you want to stay in Bombay, Bombay is hub of all Bollywood and so much entertainment. So everybody likes to stay in Bombay, but you know, the cost of living and the difficulties of living just make it impossible without proper, you know, revenue to stay here. What to speak of, you know, South Bombay. So this person decided it's nice forest life, and you have your own room, you have ultra fast internet, and so why leave and go to some place and whatever pleasures you want, you just get outside the gate or inside the gate. So therefore he chose that life is so comfortable, I'll continue with that roll number and continue to stay in the hostel. I don't know what happened now, I didn't check on him after I graduated. But some of us, or the living entities, when they become accustomed to the life in this world, we kind of get adjusted, even though there are so many troubles, disappointments that we may face, still we kind of settle ourselves or compromise to the situation because this is something that we are aware of. And therefore, nature itself and the scriptures, they try to unsettle those who kind of settle in this artificial environment. And that's the unsettling the settled. And there are different, and this is the fear element that is trying to propel one to go out of this situation, to go out of this material circumstances. Because if you continue to stay here, you will become infected, you will suffer more and more. It's not that, okay, now that you're compromised, like Krishna says in the Gita, dukkalayam ashashvatam. That dukkalayam is, yes, there are so many miseries in this world, but then
The miseries also keep changing. Ashashvatam. They are temporary. Once you get used to one misery, one type of lifestyle, say currently lockdown is happening, we kind of get used to this, then things start to open and the situation changes, the challenges change, and again so much of our energy and consciousness goes in trying to adjust to that situation, and then that situation changes. So instead of, you know, but somehow or other, because the living entity in the natural situation is in a very, you know, settled atmosphere of the spiritual world, that tendency to find a settlement is there. Also, one of the brahmacharis, when I had come, say 15 days back, for the first kind of week or 10 days, he didn't say for any service or any kind of, you know, this class request. But then he came and said, Prabhuji, I think you're settled now. So now, would you mind giving class, or mind doing this service, or do you mind doing this new course or other things? And this trying to settle is anyway a very strong drive, even in Brahmachari ashram. If our locker changes, we get bothered. If the place where we sit in prasadam line, especially in the Mahaprasadam line, if that gets changed by someone, we become bothered. So the unsettling naturally disturbs the consciousness. But here in Parikshit Maharaj and the whole Bhagavatam is showing us how can we be stable and fully situated in Krishna consciousness in spite of all the things that will unsettle our life. Just like there is the different types of vehicles. There are some vehicles like, say, BMW or Mercedes-Benz, which can just, no matter what type of road it is, they don't unsettle the person. There are ads that show that you can keep full brim water glass, and you drive, and it doesn't even, you know, move. So yes, there are no berms, there is motion, but the inside environment is created in such a way that nothing externally influences what is happening inside. Of course, then the air conditioning is also there, that it doesn't matter what type of weather is there outside. Inside, it's the perfect temperature that you can have. And so... the whole journey of spiritual life is to go from being a thermometer to being a thermostat. A thermometer usually responds to external stimulus, external environment. And so therefore, when you have fever, when you want to see temperature, you just see that thermometer. And what does the thermometer do? The thermometer responds to the external environment and rises, and it shows whether it's 100 degrees, whether it's, you know, 99 degrees. Like yesterday night, somehow I was having some mild fever, and I was really fearful doubtful if I will be able to give the class. And I also was aware of the situation in the temple where we don't have many senior devotees or brahmacharis around, or congregation devotees. So it will be a very difficult task for Rudranath Prabhu to find an alternative speaker at 10 p.m. in the night. Because I had another class that just ended at 9:45 yesterday. And then that's when I realized actually fever is a lot, and I'm also having headache. But then I try to phone him up. Usually most brahmacharis, they're knocked out by then. And so the thermometer, it responds to the external stimulus. But whereas the thermostat, what does it do is that it adjusts the situation, or it brings the temperature back to a set. It's like, you know, almost all air conditioners are thermostats. You set 26 degrees, you set 25 degrees. And no matter how hot it is on the road, it just, you know, brings the environment to that stable situation. And our consciousness in current situation is like a thermometer. We get affected by what people say, by what people don't speak out or behave. And we are all influenced. And some of us are very sensitive, like a soda bottle, immediately we respond. And some of us are like water. Slowly the heat increases. And suddenly they start to boil, they'll explode. So whether it's soda bottle, immediate explosion, impulsive, or over a period of time somebody breaks down or somebody gets influenced, still the external influences affect us. And what Shukadeva Goswami has taught or given the message here in the Bhagavatam is how you can be Tasma Sarvatmana Rajan. That, O Parikshit Maharaj, that in all situations, Hridistham Kuru Kesham, you should be able to place in your heart Krishna. Because this space is usually occupied by our own thoughts, selfish thoughts, or worries, anxieties. And even in the japa time, we try to place Krishna in that heart, in the throne of the heart. But our consciousness is going all over and it keeps flickering, like a flickering image. Sometimes Krishna appears, we try to place Krishna there. And most of the times, something else takes over. And therefore they say that what you celebrate in your life or what you are conscious of is what you are worshipping. So if you are conscious of the current, the whole media frenzy that's going on about drugs or other things, that's what we are actually paying our attention to. That's what we are worshipping. And if you are conscious of Krishna, then that's what we are worshipping. So worship is only a manifestation of what is in our consciousness. And based on catering our time or energy, that determines our consciousness or what is in the heart. And so Shukadeva Goswami is giving this last instruction to Parikshit Maharaj that Mriyamanoi Avahitastato Yasi Paramgati. And if you become a thermostat, instead of saying a thermostat, we can say Krishna stat. That if you can make your consciousness Krishna stat, where no matter what kind of environment is there, you always come back to Krishna. And a thermostat is not something that doesn't respond to external environment. It just doesn't allow that our practice. But when there is enough gas and our Padarenu Prabhu, he keeps checking all different either the fans or the air conditionings. And one of the main things is the gas should not get leaked. And it should be in enough quantity. And then, so that gas that will keep the thermostat running is that enthusiasm. And no matter it's 10-year-old practice or 20-year-old practice, the moment our enthusiasm to do our spiritual practices goes down, the gas goes down, then we again start to go from being a thermostat to again a thermometer, and we get influenced, we get affected by what people say or what is happening around us. And another thing that Srila Jiva Goswami that speaks in regard to this particular verse, he is saying that Shukadeva Goswami, this particular word, that with all your might, Sarvatmana Rajan, yeah. Tasma sarvatmana rajan hristam kuru keshavam. So he is using this word kuru. Kuru means you have to do something actively to be able to place that mind in stillness. And there is all scientific study also in this, that usually people try to have a still mind or a focused mind, but usually the mind is very mobile, it's going all over the place. And physiologically there is an effect with the body, that how do we handle the body, that's how the mind also responds. So the study that shows is that when the body is in motion, then the mind is still. And when the body is still, the mind is in motion. And of course, we can do both. We can be moving, like in our japa, and still be focused, but it takes usually more difficult practice to keep the mind not distracted, or the body affects the mind. And to keep the mind still, we have to be active externally. It's not just like the way Arjuna wanted to do. He wanted to just disassociate himself with all the activities of his responsibility and just go and be still. That way his mind will be stable. But in living, in the art of living, it's not by not being active that the mind can be in control, but it is in being externally active in the proper way, not that any way, that we can actually keep our mind focused. Therefore, there is that famous saying that maybe in my moral science class in my childhood, that was one of the first idioms that I learned. Idle mind is, can you complete? Is devil's workshop. Or in Hindi they say that khali bartan. What provoked for us to actually keep the mind stable, because the mind will go everywhere. And the whole study has been done that those people who are usually just not moving much, they are just sedentary lifestyle, they have more issues psychologically, especially depression, because they are not active physically. Therefore, the mind is going all over, and usually the mind goes into negative zones more than positive and then positive. So therefore, here Jeeva Goswami, he mentions this, that Kuru Keshavam. Sukadeva Goswami, of course, Parikshit Maharaj, at this stage, he didn't have to do anything now to actively do some service, because what he was doing itself was intense meditation on Krishna, and he had reached through his other practice through his life to this stage where externally he doesn't have to do anything to focus his consciousness on Krishna. And this is the stage of, highest, where, in spite of not, engaging in physically, we can be absorbed mentally. But most of us, we can't directly jump to that stage. We have to use all the gifts, all the talents, abilities, our natures that Krishna has given to its full perfection. And then our ego will allow us, now that it has got a proper identification, it will allow us to fully get absorbed. Therefore, in the Vedic system, there is the brahmachari, grahastha, and vanaprastha and sannyas. And the stage of grahastha is not just, it's not necessarily about getting married. Of course, it does mean that having a house and having a wife, there is the whole concept of brahmastha, that I won't get married, nor do I submit to a particular ashram, brahmachari ashram. But the whole underlying principle of grahastha ashram is that you have certain proclivities and inclinations and natures that you have, and the stage of brahmacharya is to identify them. Because you usually, after spending some time with yourself or just your activities, you start to, you know, figure out. Usually a child used to join by the age of, you know, five or eight or ten. And then, you know, by the age of 25, it was time for him to graduate. And in those, you know, 20 of those 20 years, once you have spent those initial 10 years, usually by the age of 15, the child himself, the boy himself or the girl herself starts to understand what is my true nature. Because initially, we all just want to be that is of praiseworthy, something that is looked up to. Like we want to sing that way, we want to dance that way, we want to speak that way. But as we try to do that, we kind of realize, no, I really can't be like that. I can't really do that. And then, you know, Radha Gopinath Pumil nicely explains that, you know, 5 years goes in, whom should I, imitate? And the next 5 years goes in trying to imitate. And after trying to imitate, next 5 years goes in trying to not imitate and trying to be yourself. So in this way, 15 years in the ashram just goes in just to trying to figure out how do I serve in a happy way with full enthusiasm. And so if it'll happen if you join at the age of 5 or if you join at the age of 25. And we have seen that even in ashram life or if a devotee joins any temple or even in marriage, it is only after spending some time in that situation, in that relationship, you start to figure out what's actually working, what's not working, where am I situated. Therefore, most brahmacharis join at the age of 25. And usually they start to figure out around 35 or 40 that they are not really a fit in this situation, or they have some nature which may not, be adjusted in this situation. So the same, the trend that happens in Gurukul also happens in modern context, but just that there is all the other things that it also interferes with our bodily cycle, where there is other needs of, being a father, being somebody occupies a space. So there is a lot of interference. So therefore, it becomes much more difficult as someone gets older to decide which ashram to be in or which service to be in. But if it is done younger, then there is not those ego issues or security issues, and a person can just follow what is one's true calling. And the stage of brahmacharya is to identify our nature, and the stage of grahastha is to engage our nature. That now that you know this is what you are, now utilize that to benefit yourself, to grow yourself, and also contribute to the society. And I was very surprised when I was reading Mahabharata in the first parva, when Vyasadeva was very much kind of concerned that how will I put down this mammoth scripture of 100,000 verses to the population of Kali Yuga. He wanted a scribe, he wanted somebody who could write. But how can he approach? Because this is not just small task like in the ashram. If you want milk, you can tell Ankur Prabhu, or you can tell someone, Baldev Shakti Prabhu, can you just get me this milk? If it's just 2 minutes, 5 minutes service, we don't mind telling someone, just requesting. But we'd say it's something that is going to take months of engagement or years of engagement. And then you can't just approach anyone and then kind of force them. And usually in such situations, what do we do? That when there is somebody has needed for a project or some kind of initiative, we usually go to the authorities and say, Prabhuji, ye seva hai, this is a service, a long-term service, BTG, no editorialship or whatever. And then please assign someone for this project, for this service. So same way, so it is explained that Vyasadeva, he was intensely meditating and praying to Krishna, to Lord Brahma and to Lord Shiva, that how can I do this service and please give me guidance and direction in this. And because of his sincere desire, Brahmaji arrives there. It's always said that unless the disciple, unless we are properly, in proper hunger to look up to, wanting the advice, Krishna won't send proper advice or proper guru to actually guide us. So the initiative is first from our side, that we want to sincerely progress, we want to sincerely do that service, and then Krishna will provide the guidance in some way or other. So Brahmaji arrives there, and when Brahmaji arrives there, he doesn't have to mention the issue that he is facing. Who will volunteer for this service? This word volunteer is quite famous in non-profit organizations or in temples. And there was just a few days back, I was hearing something about, there are different ways to do service, different ways. So this word servant is somebody, when you tell them something, they will do it. So that's a servant. Then we have the word sevak. Of course, it's just a play of words, but it gives a good understanding about, the way we serve. Then there is a sevak. He anticipates what is needed. And he is ready to, with the required infrastructure or whatever to provide that service. Whereas somebody who is just a ritualistic servant, once the order comes, or even if it comes verbally, you will say, no, you have to email me first. Or, you have to follow all the protocols, then I will do the service. So that's a sevak, one who anticipates and who, like Hanumanji, he understood the mood of Ramachandra and he did the service even before he was told. So that's called as the best servant, first class servant. Then the second class is, we can say a servant who you have to tell, some of the servants that we have that clean up. Now when you tell them, do this, then they will do that. And of course, if they voluntarily take up and if there's something goes up, then the whole trouble comes upon them. So even though they may have that spirit, they may not do it. Then there is a third category. They will only serve when they feel like. It's not about when you tell, or it's not when there is a need. Their service will depend on their feelings or when they feel like. And this person had categorized these class of servants or as volunteers. So there is no responsibility upon them that they will volunteer to help in the crowd control. And suddenly they'll see, okay, something else has come, then they'll escape, then they'll go away. And initially, of course, everyone volunteers based on our feelings, based on our time to come to Krishna, to serve, to chant holy names. But at that stage, the relationship or trust in Krishna that this person can actually take up bigger mission is not there. So we have to move from being just a volunteer. Of course, the voluntary spirit is important, but just doing service based on how I feel, when I feel, it won't work, especially in a community. It is time for lunch to be cooked and the wife says, today I didn't feel like cooking. What will happen? Everyone will go hungry. So in a community, in a family, in an institution, we can't just arrange everything based on when someone feels like. And this is not a compulsive that we have to put. It is each individual that takes up that responsibility along with that voluntary spirit. And that's the best, you know, match that we can have. And so that is engaging one's nature. That is usually the grahastha ashram. That you have a particular nature, and unless you fully engage that, you don't feel fulfillment. You don't feel a sense of satisfaction, or as they say, job satisfaction. And this is true with those who are, somebody has a proclivity to, paint. Unless they actually do that, they won't feel satisfied. Somebody who is a, say, singer, unless they sing and then they have nice kirtan or what music, they won't feel fulfilled. Or say somebody is an intellectual, unless they barge in a lot of just study a lot and solve problems or do actually solve a problem, they don't feel fulfilled. And this is because of the particular nature that we have. And we all need to honor the nature that we are carrying. But honor not in the sense that, just this is what I am, but engage it in Krishna service. So whether it's in Brahmachari ashram, whether it's in Grihastha ashram, or any place, Krishna consciousness accepts all different natures. And that's why it is so wonderful that every nature can be dovetailed to in Krishna service. Somebody is an intellectual, we can study the scriptures and share the wisdom. Somebody is a kshatriya, he can very well administer and ensure things are all going. He can protect the devotees, he can ensure the systems are in place so that there is no trouble. And recently Brajbihari Prabhu, Washington DC devotee, he was having this discussion with Chaitanya Charan Prabhu in this monk's podcast. And there was a interesting discussion that happened that, sometimes when you go into institutional setup or services, or then usually you kind of feel that this is all, a structured system where I don't feel any kind of service, and it is not mentioned. The three things that are mentioned is Nama Ruchi, Jeev Daya and Vaishnava Seva. And where is all this? And he gave a very nice understanding. He said, this is how I see my involvement, my responsibilities. I don't see responsibilities as a manager, as a temple commander, as this, as that, as being in a corporate setup. But I see these as the ways I can serve a larger community of devotees. If I was not in this situation, maybe I would have just helped one devotee to cook for him some meal. But if I am in the proper setup, then I can assist so many devotees to facilitate in their devotion service. So, and he said, it gives me a lot of solace when I see my responsibilities as Vaishnava Seva rather than, something that is inhibiting. And that, obviously, that voluntary spirit is important. And we need to honor that nature and engage that nature. And that's what is Grihastha Ashram. And even as a brahmachari, because of the age, because of our psychophysical nature, we have to honor it and we have to engage it to actually feel fulfilled. And if not, then it becomes very difficult for us to actually fully absorb in Krishna, because there is a part of us which is still materially conditioned. We may have spiritual understanding, but we are all very much connected to the body, attached to the body, the mind influences us. And just like when you make dough, you take atta and then you take water and then you start to mix. Initially, when you start to mix, how many of you here have made atta? Okay, most of you have made atta. Or any kind, it's like anyone that has cooked, this is a common example. So when you make atta, initially, one of my revelations when I was at IIT Bombay, we were having the base and we were cooking ourselves. And one of my first services that Brachand Prabhu engaged me into was to make atta. Our college timings were, I think, from morning 8:30 to 12:30. And then there was a break of 1.5 hours, and 2 o'clock, again 2 to 5 was, again classes or labs, different things. So we just had 1.5 hours. And I had to come on my cycle very quickly and make that atta. And we used to make, just like the temple standards, we all had temple standards, that hot, fresh chapatis will be served to all the devotees. And our dear Shyamcharan Prabhu used to make the best chapatis, the thick chapatis and the different parathas. And of course, it was a joyous time along with different challenges. And when I was making that atta, that time I was still, no, not yet maybe chanting 16 rounds or not yet. But initially when I used to see that dry powder and that water, it just didn't fit my logic. How is this going to get bound up with that? But as I tried to push my hands into that properly, mix the water, slowly I started to see, hey, this is all comes together. So you don't have to understand everything logically. First, start to experiment, but start to involve. Then you'll start to see how everything will fit together. Otherwise, Krishna consciousness will purify your emotions and it will take you back to Godhead. These are all something mythical, something magical. But making that atta, doing that service, somehow, in a mystical way, gave me that conviction. Just like atta can be made, although it doesn't seem logical, same way bhakti will also someday, actually help me to make something of my life. So with atta, what can you do? You can't do much. But with dry atta, but with actual dough, you can do so many items. There are unlimited varieties of items that you can make with once you mix water and dough. But there's a challenge. When you're mixing water and atta, wheat powder, usually starts to stick, right? As you're putting water, it starts to stick. And that's one of the very troublesome situations that all of us face as we are making atta. Because before you started the practice, your hands were free, you were a free bird. But now that you have put your hands into that, you can't go anywhere. It's just like sadhana bhakti. Atta bana rahe, lekin pura chipak rahe. It doesn't seem to form properly. And it needs proper guidance. And obviously I got my guidance from one of our devotees, Nanda Kumar Prabhu, who is now in US. He's a professor. And he taught me, when do you put water and how do you put water and what is the proper mixture in which you can't just, okay, itna pani lagega, itna atta ke liye. You can't just mix everything initially and just try to bring it out. There's a process that you have to follow to bring that atta to perfection. And the middle stage will be sticky, will be something that is very bothersome. And even with engaging our nature, like Maharaj, His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj explains, that Arjuna, it was Arjuna's nature to be a Kshatriya. And Krishna, when he gave instruction to Arjuna, Krishna didn't tell him to do some other nature which is not him. It was his nature which Krishna told Arjuna to engage in. And although it was Krishna's instruction to fight, and although it was his own nature to fight, to stand for dharma, still it was not easy to fight. Still it was difficult to shoot Drona, to shoot Bhishma, to handle the death of his own son Abhimanyu. And the whole message that Maharaj was giving was that even if you follow your nature, still surrendering to the will of Krishna, because there will be difficulty as we are trying to practice music, even though it may be your skill, if you want to really be good at it, something that is worthwhile for the audience, even though you may be good at it, in cooking, you have to invest and there will be troubles. And that's where tolerance and all the spiritual attitude comes. Otherwise, if somebody is very highly intellectual, he can just do things, he can just, you know, learn so much. But trouble comes when they face challenges, when they face some kind of failures. That's when attitude, that's when that, you know, being there in that sticky situation and continuing to make the atta, make that dao. But slowly and surely, that atta that was sticking so much, as you're following the process, there's a stage that comes where the atta doesn't stick anymore. It becomes a homogeneous substance. You know, there is adhesive force and there is cohesive force. So, adhesive force is where you stick to something external. That this particular object, when it sticks to another object, it is called as adhesive force. But cohesive force is when you don't stick to something external, but you stick to what is yours. Like when you pour water from a glass, especially if it's a water glass. Water and glass, that material, silicon, have a strong adhesive force. So they kind of stick to each other. So therefore, when you try to pour from a glass, usually it follows the line. And you know, you can't really pour fully well. But if you take a steel glass, or especially when there is that, you know, aperture, that is groove, then you know that adhesive force is reduced and you can properly pour. Right now, we all have a lot of adhesive force. We just stick to anything and everything that is around us, and there is hardly any cohesive force. We don't stick to our inner nature or to Krishna, that is truly our Lord. And the process of bhakti, again, from being a thermometer to a thermostat, is to move from adhesive nature to cohesive nature. And so that atta, it reduces its adhesive nature, it doesn't stick anymore, and it becomes cohesive. It just sticks to itself. And once it attains that nature, then you can make anything out of it. You can make a samosa, you can make a roti, you can make anything. And no matter where you put that atta, that particular cohesive nature that it has come, it won't get attached to that. Because now it has become totally binded to itself, to its inner nature. So that's what is the stage of grihastha ashram, is of making atta. Is that you have your nature, but your nature is very much sticking to you, and you can't just, you know, get away with it, but develop it, process it to a stage where you can fully, you know, be ready to offer that nature that you have to Krishna. And that's what is the later stages of grihastha ashram, which is vanaprastha, where you test yourself, your adhesive nature, how much do you stick back to your family, back to your past, back to your other things. So vanaprastha stage is a stage where experimenting kitna chipakta hai. And you know, we all do this. We take the atta and we see. We put and we see chipakta hai kya. So therefore, there is the different stages. There is the kutichak, the grihastha first, you know, removes himself from the family, stays in a hut outside the village. Then he only takes meal from one time a day. So he's testing himself. Am I still sticking to that nature? Is my material ego fully satisfied in such a way that I can actually give up that nature? Just like, you know, when we are hungry, we can't think of anything else except hunger. But once we are filled with in the belly, then we can not think about other services. Same with our ego. The nature that we have, it has to be satisfied. It has to be engaged. Then it will allow us to actually fully do something else. Otherwise, you know, you will always be in two minds. Main jab karu ki main seva karu, because, you know, two things are dragging. But once your japa is done, at least the 16 rounds, then you are fully ready. I know in our yatra kitchens, it's kind of a rule that you complete your rounds, you shouldn't bring your bead bag to the kitchen, because then you are in two minds, japa karu ki seva karu. But once your hunger is full, then you can fully focus in the service. Same way, once your nature, and this is once the ego, by engaging, becomes, then it can disengage from just being material. And now the consciousness no more wanders in the realms of matter, of emotions, of just material things. Now it is ready to actually absorb fully into Krishna. And that's the stage of Vanaprastha. And it did not happen at 50 or later. We all will go through this, and we have to actively work to push this this nature towards its perfection. And if you just know very lethargic about it, it will never move. If we want to make Krishna consciousness a reality, we have to actively work about identifying the nature, engaging the nature, which is the grahastha, then the vanaprastha, which is testing whether I have fully come off. Like Prabhupada gives his story of the judge who just gave up being a judge and all the money in the name of Satyagraha movement, in the name of independence movement, but it took so much of his consciousness, he was so worried, and he eventually committed suicide. He ended his life because he was still that sticky atta, he was still sticking to his past conditioning, his past comforts, all those things that he was used to. So he still didn't become a cohesive person, he still was a adhesive person. And then the final is the sannyas. He is where now that you no more identify, you are fully happy or satisfied with your accomplishments. You don't have to prove anything to yourself or to anyone else. As somebody said, if you want to prove anything to anyone, then you are a prisoner. Because you are bound by that thought that I need to prove myself. But a devotee doesn't want to prove anything, he just wants to improve in his service to Krishna, he wants to engage his full self to Krishna. And that's what here Sukadeva Goswami is saying, that because Parikshit Maharaj had followed all this, and now he has, at the final stage, he was not even attached to living, or he was insulted, anything. He just was ready in the stage of sannyas, where he was fully capable to absorb Kuru Keshavam. And this is what Jiva Goswami explains. Hridistham Kuru Keshavam Mriyamano Abhita. So the time of death is where is the like that, and the calculator, when we go to some shop, they'll do all the different items, they'll keep entering. And at the end, once the whole purchase is done, they'll press the equal to button. So Tamal Krishna Maharaj explains, death is like that, pressing that equal to button. Everything that you have accumulated will appear there. And if you have not did well, if you have not prepared your atta well, then it will stick to you. And anything materially, if it sticks to you, you will stick back to that. You will again take another life, another birth. As Prabhupada says, if you are attached to a rasgulla, you will again have to come to the material world, because you got sticked to that rasgulla. And but once we become fully cohesive with Krishna consciousness, with our true nature, then at the time of death, we can fully absorb. And then tato yasi param gatim, we can fully go there. And all these other things that Sukadeva Goswami is mentioning, they can only take us few yards outside of us. Like in every home, I'll just end with this example and stop the class, because today is Sunday. I was given some extra time to share. Almost every home, they have two types of vehicles. One is for a long commute, another is for a short commute. You have to just go to the bazaar, or and if you take your big car, your SUV, to try to take to this Bendi bazaar or anything, first of all, it won't enter there. It's such an inconvenience, and it's waste of its capacity to just utilize that such a big vehicle to go there. So the best is to walk. Any short commute, we just walk. because that helps us to know to exercise. And if it is not such a convenient to walk, then you take a cycle or a two-wheeler. Usually every home has a four-wheeler and a two-wheeler. Two-wheelers are usually used for short commutes, unless some crazy guys that go on a intercontinental drive. And four-wheelers are usually used for long commutes. Same way, all these other things that are being mentioned about worshipping the demigods, or following austerities, or controlling the senses, all these will help us for short commute, to achieve something that is close by, something that is nearby. You want to control your senses, you want to focus on your work better, you want to handle your relationships nicely. But if you try to use a cycle or try to walk to Vrindavan, it's very difficult, because that vehicle cannot support that journey. And so based on what is your goal, you have to choose the vehicle. So most people, they just have a short goal. They just live in one particular zone and they never leave out. For them, they always, you just use short vehicles, which is worshipping the devatas or other things. But for those who know that this place is temporary, I need to move out, I need to do a long commute, then they understand that it is only bhakti that can take me, that to unalloyed bhakti, that is a proper vehicle that can actually take me far beyond. Although other vehicles like walking can still take you to Vrindavan, but you may die before reaching there, it will be very troublesome. So all these other paths, they take long time and they are also very troublesome. You can still use them for short, for just temporary conveniences, but for long journey, and especially to perfect our life, it is only absorbing fully in Krishna consciousness, which here is explained, yata hridi sthite bhagavati anante, that if you want to really absorb yourself in the unlimited Lord, then the vehicle and the ammunition, the fuel that is in that vehicle should be something that is unending, and that's what is ahetuki bhakti, and that's what is being recommended here as the last instruction. And if we follow the journey that Parikshit Maharaj followed, and we'll also reach that stage where we can make a wonderful paratha and offer it to Shishi Radha Gopinath during the Mangal Bhog, as it is happening now. And that's the journey from being in the field from a seed to coming onto the plate and ultimately to the mouth of the Supreme Lord. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki. Already it's late, I won't take any questions.